I am so glad you are here. Welcome. If you are new to New Creation, you have just found your church family. Just saying. It's been a blessing over the years to be here, to worship, to gather, to sing praises to our awesome God. And I trust that as you're here today, you will feel God's presence in a powerful way. He's come to be with us. And we're grateful that we can worship him in music. We're grateful we can worship him in praises and petitions. And at this time, I'd like to invite Virginia to come forward and take our prayer and praise time. But we're just delighted you're here. We hope that you have a great Sabbath experience.
Good morning. Who enjoyed this week? Did you see that sun? You know, we hadn't seen it for 120 hours. And then it came out. And boy, did that affect us, right? Who had a good week? Oh, how did God bless you? How did God bless you this week? Who has the roaming mic? Anybody with a roaming mic?
I will start.
Okay, well, we find a mic, right? Okay.
While they're grabbing the
there
mic.
We go. Start, Mike.
Oh, sorry. I had such a good week this week, and this morning was our last time where we got together online with our 21 days of prayer and fasting. And that was just a wonderful experience, and I'm just so grateful. And for all who participated in that, I don't know if you feel like I do, but I feel kind of sad that it's come to an end. But so grateful that we got to experience it.
Oh, that's great. Selena, your hand was up. You had a good week. How?
The sun was out. I'm catching up at work. No complaints. It's a good life, you know.
Awesome. That's a good week.
That's a good week. Who else had something special that they wanted
right
to
here,
share?
Right here, right behind you, Austin.
Well, not this week, but next week on Monday, I get to start a new job. So I'm excited about that.
Wow. That's exciting. Tell us what it is.
Oh, I'm going to go from an audit customer service to an actual auditor for my company. So.
Fantastic. Well, congratulations. Patricia, your hand was up. Oh, you lost the mic already. Go ahead.
So tomorrow night, Carolyn and Austin are going to be inviting me for supper tomorrow. So I'm kind of thankful for that. And then the last a couple of nights, I've been blessed too. Like right now in the world, we're all financially struggling. And so I've been blessed. And I'm not living without. And so I'm thankful for that too.
Amen.
Yeah, God provides, doesn't he?
Onto that, we're really excited to see Ian, and we're looking forward to talking with him every week. And we can also add on to his thankfulness. We've done the kind of same thing the last few months. We've been financially struggling, but because the Lord keeps us, he gives us what we need when we need it. He brings us through, so we have that same thankfulness.
Amen. Absolutely. Patricia, I saw your hand up.
Well, other than having a really good week, I have 45 more days left of school, and then I am officially an associate's, I can't even think of the word now.
Associate's degree.
Yeah.
Fantastic. Excellent. Yeah. That is very good.
Thank you.
Eric.
Hi. I actually made it through my whole probation and I'm off everything now, so praise God that everything made it through, and I'm still
kicking. Yeah, that is good.
Well, you know, the Lord blessed me this week because I sell real estate, and I'm old, and I had out-of-town people, and they wanted to see 9 houses. Did you know how many sets of stairs are in 9 houses? I do, and I got through it. We actually saw 11, and I made it through it. God was with me, wasn't he? Yeah, that's a blessing. Who else? Anybody behind me? Lisa's just happy the snow melted.
That's right.
She's got a driveway again.
Get up my driveway.
Absolutely. How about prayer requests this morning? Yes, right up here in front.
My mom had to go to the hospital yesterday with severe abdominal pain, and she has to have emergency surgery to take her gallbladder out, so she's in a lot of pain right now, but doing okay so that, you know, surgery goes well and that she recovers. So I know she's in good hands, but, you know, still scared.
And her name?
Tema, T-E-M-A.
Okay, and who'll take that? Patricia's going to pray very earnestly all week for a good recovery. Nice outcome on that. Way in back. Ray.
My wife, Jamie, is dealing with some really severe back pain. We went to the ER on Tuesday. They diagnosed her with sciatica. Nothing they gave her is working. She's been to the chiropractor. She's been stretching, using a heat pad. Nothing is working for more than a few minutes.
Ooh.
So please pray for her.
Absolutely. Who'll take that prayer? Oh, Josie's going to take that prayer. Anybody that's had sciatica is going to take that prayer. Believe you me.
I think Josie also has a prayer request.
Oh, yes, Josie.
I received a text. I'm reading the text here from Paula. She said, please pray that my dogs come home and are safe. They have never been gone this long before. I've driven all over and can't find them. Jack and Jill are missing.
Yeah, she's got 2 big dogs. Who'll take the prayer request? Derek's going to pray for those dogs. Any other prayer request? I've got one. There's a young gentleman by the name of Cameron that we need to pray for, that he recovers from what's ailing him. Who'll take that request? Right there. Let's bow our heads. Kind Father, you're always with us. You take away our fear. You tell us to fear not. Be with us. Father, we love you.
We want to spend eternity with you. Come take us home. Amen.
Amen. I don't know about you, but I was so excited when I got up this morning. We could come and worship the Lord in our 21 days of praying. Today, our theme is thankfulness. And we're just going to give him praise today. So we're going to invite everyone to stand together. And we're going to sing this great song, looking forward to the second coming, soon and very soon. Everybody. Soon. All right, here we go, everybody.
Soon and very soon, we are going.
Let's pray together. Father God, we worship you today. We come before you with our singing, with our fellowship, with our hearts wide open. And we beg that the Holy Spirit will come and just fill us. Fill this whole room, Lord. I pray that you will be glorified by what we bring and blessed. Our goal today is to bring a smile on your face. Father God, you are so good, and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So, all right, you may be seated, but I've always loved this song. But when I was a kid, I used to look it up, and I'm like, what is a pionder? Because the role is called one. And that always bothered me. I hope I didn't just ruin the song for everybody now. But let's sing this great song, When the Roll is Called Up Yonder. Here we go.
When the trumpet of the marching sounds, the time shall be no more. And the morning breaks eternal bright and fair. When the sailors shall gather over on the other shore. And the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there.
Here we go.
When the roll is called.
different feel now. All right, here we go.
Let us labor for the master, for the dawn, the setting sun. Let us talk of all his wondrous love and care. Then when all of life is over and our work on earth is done, then the roll is called and yonder I'll be there. When the roll is called of yonder, 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 I'll be there.
Camp meeting song. This next song is one of my soundtrack songs right now. It's a song I sing in the shower, in the car, wherever I go. Sing it with us, everybody. At your name, the mountains shake and crumble. Sing it as an anthem of prayer that says, bless the Lord, oh my soul. And just really sing it out here. This is another wonderful soundtrack song. Everybody.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship your holy name.
Sun's up.
When we were singing the second to last song, just shout your name, we shout your name, we shout your name. I'm so glad that we have a God we can shout his name in joy for the times when things are amazing, and we can also cry his name when things are hard, and we can whisper his name. And he hears those whispers that are even silent in our hearts for whatever we're going through. And I was just trying to picture all these shouts, all these cries, just the name of Jesus going up to heaven all the time, all around the globe. And he hears each one of us, whatever Amen. Our situation Amen. Is. And I want to testify real quick. I have some team members that are on the ground again in Ukraine and got a text message from them, just sharing a text message from the front lines from a soldier that we'd met and just telling us to keep on praying. He's like, I've lost 70% of my battalion. They're either dead, they're captured, they're missing, or wounded. And he's like, but our prayers are going up hotter than they are in churches. The pressure is on, the cries go up, the Lord hears. And he said, but even my bosses, even the commanders, want to be near me because I'm a believer. Our cries go up, especially in times of difficulty, and the Lord hears, and he shows himself faithful to us, whatever our situation is, whatever your situation is. He's faithful to you. Father in heaven, God, I thank you that we can worship you who are unseen by us, but we're not unknown by you. That nothing concerning us escapes our notice, whether we're in a good chapter or we're in a hard chapter, whether we're here worshiping freely or we are on the other side of the planet in war or in persecution, hiding for our faith. Whatever it is, God, I thank you that you see all, you hear all. Father, that you would continue to open our eyes to see where you're answering the cries of our hearts today, the cries for help, the cries of thanksgiving for what you've done in answer to some prayers. God, that I just thank you for your faithfulness to us throughout all generations. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. You may be seated. I'm going to invite the deacons to come forward, and we're going to collect our offering, and just going to let you know the loose offering, of course, goes to the Ministry of New Creation, and but there are other ways that you can also give, and one is you can go to our website, newcreation.community, and or if you're more techie than I am, you can go to QR code that's about to go up there, and which is way more techie than me, and it'll take you right to the place where it's our conference, a website, and give you all kinds of ministries in our church where you can give, and we're a part of a worldwide church, and you can give. Tithes and offerings in that way too. But let's just pray and ask God to do what he does every time. He takes our little gifts and he turns it into something beautiful. Father God, thank you. We thank you so much that you are a generous God and you shower us with good gifts every day. Every good gift is your gift. But Lord, I pray that this little offering, this little thank you, will be acceptable to you, that it will show that we are so honored that you would care for us. And I pray that you will take this offering, that you will grow it, expand it, that you will use it to grow your kingdom. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I love First Sabbath because we have Ed Wagner here. He's going to do our offertory for us. Amen, right? Wow, I could listen to that all day. So, like, one of these days, maybe we'll just do that. Hey, I want to invite our kids to come up, but before we do, we have our Lamb's offering, and it goes to our benevolent fund. If you'd like to give to that, all you have to do is pull out something, and the kids will take it up for you. So pull out some offering, and the kids will see you waving it. And we're going to stick it right here in our little church. And we're going to invite Jesse to come forward. And he's going to be telling us a story. But our kids, anyone who's a kid, anyone who identifies as a kid, come on forward. And we got plenty of room up here. And but thank you so much. Just wave it. So, yeah, we're teaching our kids that when someone waves money, you grab it. And you stick it in the church. So come on forward. Anyone is a kid or someone like Kelly who identifies as a kid still, definitely. So come on forward. Jesse, we're glad you're here.
Come on forward. Take a little time to gather a dollar. That's good. All right. Thank you, boys and girls, for helping us with that Lamb's offering. Very good. Nope, we got a few more up here. And I just realized I'm going to have to be really careful in telling my story today because my boss is here and she may assess me on my teaching skills. But no, it's good to have you boys and girls here today. I wanted to just share a story that happened to me in Colorado. I grew up in Colorado. And I was kind of hoping for a little more snow because it would be kind of fitting, but it happened in Colorado. Kind of like last time, you remember I shared a story with you about a snowstorm and being caught in the snowstorm? So this one kind of comes on the tail of that one, too. So when I was growing up, I grew up in a single-parent home, my dad and my three brothers. And so I had a lot of responsibilities other than just the regular school stuff. I had to do the cooking, cleaning, laundry, and all that stuff. And sometimes I was late catching the bus, but I had a trick to do that because the bus would start here. I was the first one to be picked up and to go all the way around, and then it'd come back close to my house again. And if I timed it just right, I could cross the creek and then catch the last ride on the bus if I was running late. And so I figured out a cool trick in the middle of winter. I had to cross a creek that was about, you know, a canal, more and more of a canal. It was like 4 or 5 feet deep, you know. But in the winter, it would freeze. And sometimes you had to be careful when you were crossing a creek or a lake. You ever hear about that, crossing a lake, because you can what? Yeah, exactly right. And so you know what my trick was for that? I would take a rock, close, I'd take a rock, good size rock, and I'd throw it in the middle. And if the rock went through the ice, I knew I couldn't walk over it. But if it hit the ice and bounced, I knew it was strong enough to hold my weight. And that worked pretty good. You know, it would work pretty good. I'd throw a rock out there, it'd bounce, I'd cross the creek, you know. But one winter, I did that, and the rock, I threw it out there, and it bounced. And I'm like, oh, well, I'm good to go, right? So I go out there, but I start hearing this crack, crack, and I'm in the middle of the canal. And I'm thinking, okay, should I go back or should I just keep plunging forward? And so I decided to go forward, and then all of a sudden, whoosh, and I'm in the ice-cold water in the middle of the winter. And if you know anything about this particular canal, the water has an undercurrent. Do you guys know what that is? Right, and it keeps going, and it's pulling you as it keeps going. So I was afraid I was going to get pulled under the ice and possibly drowned, right? So I was grabbing the edge of the ice, but but every time I would grab the edge of the ice, you know what would happen? It would break. You've done this before. No, okay. Lucky guess. But it would break. You're exactly right. It would break, and then it would pull me under and break. And, of course, it's freezing cold. And I'm thinking, I might die getting pulled underneath this river and find me 10 miles down later or in springtime. So you know what I did? There were no branches. It was just curved. I cried out unto the Lord. I said, Lord, help me. It was kind of like Peter when he sunk in the ocean. I just cried. I said, Lord, help me. Because the ice was breaking. And all of a sudden, the thought in my head came to just take my arms and let them rest on the ice. Don't push down on the ice. Just let them rest on the ice. And I thought that was kind of odd because I was trying to frantically pull myself up. So I just left my arms sitting on the ice. And you know what happened? My arms froze to the top of the ice. Well, that was a good thing at that point, but what was interesting, when I tried to pull myself up, the ice didn't break, and so I was able to use leverage and pull myself and roll over on the side and get myself out. So that was kind of unusual, because I finally got to the edge, and when I was halfway up the creek going back to my house, all my clothes, I wore blue jeans and shirts, they all had froze on the way back. So I was kind of walking like a scarecrow, trying to walk back. It's really hard to take off frozen blue jeans and t-shirts, shirts, coats, when they're frozen on your body. But you know what I learned from that lesson was, you know, sometimes we as young people or even as older people think we got everything figured out and think that we have a technique or a method of getting through a situation. And sometimes that situation doesn't work. It fails us. And sometimes you as kids or as adults, sometimes things don't work out the way you quite plan. And accidents happen and things take place. You fall through the creek and through the ice. And that's a good time to cry unto the Lord. So that's what I want to leave you with. If you're having a difficult time and life's unexpected, continue to cry unto the Lord and say, Lord, help me. Okay? You guys can go back. Thank you for being so attentive.
Hey, look in front of you. Look beside you. Look behind you. Find somebody. Maybe you don't know their name, and just welcome them. Give them a good handshake. You might even be close enough. You could give them a hug. Just tell them, I'm glad you're here today. Thank you for being here today. Happy Sabbath. Might even be somebody who's on the other side of the room. You just have to take the trip over there and just say, I'm so happy you're here today. Thank you for being here. I'm glad you're here today. Thank you for being here today. God is so good, and I love when God's people come together and build each other up, because the church always has two roles, and that is to glorify God and to edify each other. And so we are here right now to glorify God and to build up each other. And God is amazing. We've been working our way through the book of Galatians. It has been such a blessing to me. I have absolutely enjoyed the book. I've enjoyed what Paul has to say. And today I'm just going to tell you, I'm going to warn you, Paul's taking us into the deep end of the pool. We're going into the deep end, so you may want to make sure you got your life jacket on for this one. Taking us to the deep end, and I think we'll be blessed for where he's going to take us. But I want to invite you to stand with me, like you just stand. The reason why we stand is it helps us to focus. It helps us to focus on the scripture, and it reminds us that the words that we're hearing, these are God-breathed words. They were written, of course, for a very specific audience. They were written for a very specific time, but because the Holy Spirit is involved, and I believe that with all my heart, I believe that these words are for us too. So I'm reading from Galatians chapter 3, 13 to 18. I'm reading in the New Living Translation. But Christ has rescued us from the curse pronounced by the law. When he was hung on the cross, he took upon himself the curse for our wrongdoing. For it is written in the scriptures, cursed is everyone who is hung on a tree. Through Christ Jesus, God has blessed the Gentiles with the same blessing he promised to Abraham, so that we who are believers might receive the Holy Spirit through faith. Dear brothers and sisters, here's an example from everyday life. Just as no one can set aside or amend an irrevocable agreement, so it is in this case, God gave the promises to Abraham and his child. And notice that the scripture doesn't say to his children, as if it meant many descendants. Rather, it says to his child, and that, of course, means Christ. This is what I'm trying to say. The agreement God made with Abraham could not be canceled 430 years later when God gave the law to Moses, because God would be breaking his promise. For if the inheritance could be received by keeping the law, then it would not be the result of accepting God's promise, but God graciously gave it to Abraham as a promise. Let's pray together. Father, I thank you so much for this scripture, and I pray that your Holy Spirit will come, will descend on this place. The same Holy Spirit that descended on your followers in that upper room, the very same Holy Spirit that descended on Cornelius and his friends, the same Holy Spirit who was there at the resurrection of Jesus. Father God, I pray that that Holy Spirit will be with us right now, will be felt in a tangible way, and that he will speak to each heart, because each one of us needs a message. And it may be different, but I pray that each one gets the one that he or she needs this day. It is not an accident, Lord. I know that, we are here. It's not an accident that even those online are with us now. You've brought us together to hear this message. I believe that with all my heart. So I pray that your Holy Spirit will just bypass me and go directly to each heart. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. There is a magic deeper still. These are the climax words from Aslan in C.S. Lewis's remarkable allegory, The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. Grown up, who can read Lewis's book without feeling the hair on the back of your neck standing on end at Aslan's prophetic words? In the land of Narnia, the young jealous boy Edmund deserved death. He had betrayed his two sisters and his brother. He had sided with the White Witch, who had made Narnia always winter, never Christmas. Edmund had proven a traitor to Narnia and to Aslan himself. Even as a 12-year-old boy, I understood the allegory of this. The White Witch was obviously Satan. And, well, I also got the fact that Aslan the Lion was Jesus. And Edmund, well, Edmund was me. And all of humanity. We are all Edmund. We have broken the law of an ancient covenant. An ancient covenant inscribed on a stone table. Like Edmund, we are traitors, all of us. We have broken the covenant with Almighty God, and all who break that covenant, called the deep magic in Lewis's allegory, all who break that covenant deserve death. Edmund must die. We deserve to die. I got it as a boy. I got it. So the White Witch reminds Aslan of what is written on the old covenant, the deep magic, that Edmund's life belongs to her. And Aslan sharply responds, "Do not cite the deep magic to me." Because Aslan knows the law better than anyone. He had written the law. He was the law. And now for the spoiler alert. Aslan agrees to take Edmund's punishment upon himself, to die Edmund's death upon the stone table. And the witch, of course, makes Aslan's death as miserable and as humiliating as possible before plunging the knife into the lion's side. And having slain the great lion, the witch and her jubilant minions then move to wage war against Aslan's remaining followers. But at that moment, when everything seemed bleakest, the stone table on which Aslan lay cracked in two. And Aslan, the son of God, emerged alive. And Edmund's sister Lucy couldn't understand what had just happened. So Aslan explains it to her. He says this: "Though the witch knew the deep magic, there is a magic deeper still which she did not know. Her knowledge goes back only to the dawn of time. But if she could have looked a little further back into the stillness and the darkness before time dawned, she would have read there a different incantation. She would have known that when a willing victim who had committed no treachery was killed in a traitor's stead, the table would crack and death itself would start working backwards." As a young boy, Lewis's story helped me grasp the gospel. I got it, but I had no capacity to fully grasp the depth of the great story until I reread it and reread it as an adult. His allegory is every bit as rich as John Bunyan's Pilgrim's Progress or Hannah Hernard's great book. I hope you've had a chance to read this book, Hind's Feet on High Places. The law that condemned Edmund to death, which is allegorically equivalent to the law of Moses, had been written on stone. It's the same law that condemns us to death, according to Paul. But Aslan spoke of a deeper magic. That is a deeper covenant, an even older covenant. Likewise, the Apostle Paul speaks in Galatians of a deeper magic, a deeper covenant still. But can that really be so? Is there actually an older covenant than the law of Moses from which comes our hope? Is there an older covenant that trumps the law of Moses? A deeper covenant that assures us salvation from the law's death penalty? Yes. Yes, there is. Fashioned before the foundation of time, God had a plan for us, fixing it in place forever in a contract made with a pagan named Abram. Paul refers to it in Galatians 3. And first he reminds us this. He says, "But Christ has rescued us from the curse pronounced by the law. When he was hung on the cross, he took upon himself the curse for our wrongdoing. Just as Aslan the lion rescued Edmund, Jesus has rescued us. The law of Moses will never lift a finger to save us. It can't. According to Paul, it can only accuse us and reveal to us our sins. There's nothing built into it by which we might be redeemed. Nothing except that we obey its every precept perfectly. And none of us has done so. None of us. So Jesus has saved us from the law by perfectly keeping the law. He has saved us from the law's punishment by succumbing to the law's punishment. Our punishment, really. But how so? Well, Paul writes further in Galatians, "For it is written in the scriptures, cursed is everyone who is hung on a tree." The law is so clear here in Deuteronomy and throughout Torah. A curse hangs over anyone who has broken even a single command of the old command, of the old covenant. Even one. We deserve to die. From birth, we are as good as dead. And even the sacrificial system of the old covenant could never provide the permanent reprieve we so desperately need. The blood of lambs or of goats or of doves may point us towards such a hope, but it can never wash the curse away fully. Meanwhile, Satan is always there. He stands by, always pointing his ugly accusing finger, demanding that we die. For all who hoped the law of Moses would save us, we're out of luck. We have fallen short. This side of glory, we will always fall short without some intervention. The law has spoken. We deserve to die. So is there a way out? Can God save us from the condemnation of the old covenant, the old law of Moses? Is there an escape hatch? Is there a narrow gate that leads to life? There's got to be a deeper magic. Well, hallelujah, there is. There is. We find it in a very ancient blessing and promise, and it's right there in Scripture. Centuries before he ever made a covenant with Moses and the children of Israel, God took a man called Abram out among the stars. And there God asked Abram to count the stars if he could. He promised Abram that his descendants would be vast like those stars. And then God made a covenant, a mighty covenant, an unbreachable covenant, an unbreachable promise. God made a shatterproof contract between himself and Abram. Paul takes us there in Galatians. He writes this, "Dear brothers and sisters, here's an example from everyday life. Just as no one can set aside or amend an irrevocable agreement, so it is in this case. God gave the promises to Abraham and his child." And this is still Paul. And notice that the scripture doesn't say to his children, as if it meant many descendants. Here, Paul is referring to the promise God made to Abram three different times in Genesis. But specifically, right here, Paul's citing Genesis 24. God promised the childless Abram that an uncountable number of people would call him father. And that's come true. We are now among those who are his children. We call him father. But even more, he promised Abram, and still in this case, that his child, his singular offspring, would become the one and only blessing who will bless all people, who will bless the whole world. So who is this child that God is referring to? It can't be Isaac. I mean, Abraham's son Isaac is pretty great and all. He's certainly a miracle child. But he hardly seems a savior. And even if God is referring to the entire Israel, they never rise to the occasion to be a savior of the world. Paul makes clear what Genesis can only hint at. He writes, and notice that the scripture doesn't say to his children, as if it meant many descendants. Rather, it says to his child, and that, of course, means Christ. God's great promise to Abram, later renamed Abraham, is that Abraham would become a vast nation, but infinitely more significant would be the fact that out of this vast nation would come a single offspring, one child. And that child, that offspring, would be the Savior, the Redeemer, the Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Lion of Judah. Out of Abraham and Sarah's union would come in human flesh the very same God making this very same promise. And that promise was greater even than the covenant God would later make with Moses. That promise was mighty enough to fulfill the law of Moses. Paul goes on here. This is what I'm trying to say. The agreement God made with Abraham could not be canceled 430 years later when God gave the law to Moses. God would be breaking his promise. In other words, don't for a moment believe that God's lasting covenant with Abraham was canceled by the temporal covenant with Moses and the Israelites. No, the promise to Abraham would transcend the law. It would transcend everything. So according to Paul, in Galatians, 430 years before the covenant at Mount Sinai, God made a promise to Abraham. He promised Abraham an offspring, a Messiah. And this offspring of Abraham is of such importance that the old covenant of Moses would be fully accomplished and fulfilled by him. And through him, every nation is now truly blessed. And by this deeper magic, we are saved. So where precisely does this covenant truly occur? So if we turn back time 430 years plus from Mount Sinai, where does that put us? Well, it carries us all the way back to Genesis chapter 15. And it lands us in one of the most important and, dare I say, creepiest stories in the Bible. So let's turn there. Let's go there. Genesis 15. In this chapter, God gives Abraham specific instructions, very weird and ghoulish instructions. He has him take a cow, a goat, a ram, each exactly 3 years old, along with a turtle dove and a pigeon. God then instructs Abraham to hack the cow, hack the goat, hack the ram, each into halves, separating the halves until a bloody path forms between the halves. I told you, it's a little creepy. And the birds would not be cut in half, but placed on each side. The process would have probably been disgusting, messy, and agonizing. And between the mutilated animals, a soggy path of blood would form. Abraham, of course, would have recognized what was taking place. It was not an uncommon ritual. We today would probably just, I don't know, sign on the dotted line. But the ancient people had a more serious way of forming a serious contract. Two individuals wanting to form a lasting agreement would walk together on the short path between the bloody half carcasses, their feet sloshing in the blood and the mud. And often one party would carry a torch, and the other would carry a smoke sensor, because fire and smoke always symbolize the presence of the deity. Now, this ceremony would signal
that each individual had come to the most serious and unbreakable of agreements, a lasting promise between the two. And should one of the parties break his promise, that person should expect to lie dead and mutilated, just as these animals lay dead and mutilated. Abraham readies the carcasses, and then he waits for God to show up. And he waits, and he waits, and he waits. Dusk settles in. Vultures come to enjoy the dead flesh, so Abraham has to actually chase the vultures off. And then when the night falls, Abraham falls asleep. And somewhere between sleep and awake, Abraham witnesses something extraordinary. As strange as anything in Scripture, Genesis describes it this way. After the sun went down and darkness fell, Abram saw a smoking fire pot and a flaming torch pass between the halves of the carcasses. So I'm not going to lie. The image of a floating fire pot and torch between dead animals is bizarre at best. But carrying both the torch and the smoky fire pot, the invisible God passed through the bloody path between the animals. But I want you to notice something. Please notice this. Something that is incredibly striking. God didn't ask Abraham to join him. He walked the bloody path alone. Because this covenant was going to be different. God was saying to Abram, I'm sending a child who will accomplish what none other could. And should I break this promise between us, may I be like these animals, mangled and blood-soaked and dead. May the vultures want to pick the dead flesh from my body. But hear this. Please hear this. God was also promising this. Should you, Abraham, break the promise, you or any of your uncountable descendants, I will take on that punishment as well. I will be as these animals, mangled, blood-soaked, and dead. God so committed himself to our salvation that he would even take on our punishment if and when we fail to keep the covenant. God would suffer the condemnation demanded of anyone who fails to remain loyal to the covenant. I mean, I can think of no more potent illustration of what we now call the gospel than this. And it's found right in the heart of Genesis. The deeper magic, the older promise, was made 430 years before the law of Moses was even given. One might argue that the promise was hinted at just outside of Eden in Genesis chapter 3. Revelation even tells us that this promise was established before the foundation of the world. But God formally called his shot at this moment in a promise between Almighty God and an obscure Bedouin nomad. God promised then and there that he would keep his promise as well as suffer the death we deserve for failing. This was no pinky promise. This was the ultimate guarantee, a promise that could never be undone. God himself would one day be ripped to shreds as those animals had been ripped to shreds. God himself would be wounded for our transgressions and bruised for our iniquities. God himself promised to walk the bloody path for us centuries before Moses carried the old covenant down the mountain. And indeed, God walked that bloody path nearly 2,000 years later at the command of Pontius Pilate and at the wishes of the religious folk. And that's why Paul writes, This is what I'm trying to say. The agreement God made with Abraham could not be canceled 430 years later when God gave the law to Moses. God would be breaking the promise. Perhaps we can better understand then what Jesus meant when he said, before Abraham was, I am. Before Abraham, God had a plan. In the presence of Abraham, God guaranteed the plan. And then at the ninth hour, a brutally mangled Jesus, the promised offspring of Abraham, shouted from the cross, "Tetelestai, it is finished," which means literally, all is accomplished. Everything is accomplished. The promise to Abraham and all the world is fulfilled. The condemnation of the law has been satisfied, and everything is accomplished. The deeper promise has proven true. And just as Jesus said in his last breaths, everything is accomplished. A new covenant had come to this world. A new kingdom had come to power. The wounded lamb on that cross had proven himself the lion over us all. And all authority in heaven and earth is now given to him. And salvation has come to us through one man, one remarkable offspring of Abraham. Not from the law, not from our obedience to the law, but by Christ alone. By God's grace, through faith by which we, like our father Abraham, are all counted righteous. Our hope forever rests solely in the Messiah, in Jesus, in a promise made long ago to Abraham, a promise fulfilled at Golgotha. Paul writes this, he says, "For if the inheritance could be received by keeping the law, then it would not be the result of accepting God's promise." In other words, if our hope lay in the law of Moses, we wouldn't have needed the even greater promise given to Abraham. But God graciously gave it to Abraham, Paul says, as a promise. One wonders if we shouldn't refer to the new covenant of Christ as the really, really, really old covenant. The promised blessing of Abraham's singular offspring. You see, there really is a deeper magic still. The deeper magic of C.S. Lewis's allegory is the ancient promise of Scripture that our salvation would come solely by the sacrifice of God himself. And the whole world is blessed as a result. Paul's message is this: do not diminish that blessing by seeking your salvation in the law of Moses. Do not, or you are under a curse. Our salvation is in the promise. Our salvation is in the singular offspring of Abraham. Our salvation is in the Messiah Jesus alone. I don't know if you have accepted that. I don't know if you have come to Christ, the offspring of Abraham, but if you haven't, don't leave today without it. Please don't. Come to him and say, "I want that. I want to accept the promise that was given to Abraham but fulfilled there at Golgotha. I want to be born again," as Jesus said. If that's you, please don't leave this day without committing to that. If you are interested in that, then I encourage you, find myself, find Pastor Dana. She's in the lobby there. Find Pastor Frank. Find our elders. Elders, raise your hand. I think I saw some of them. Find our prayer warriors. Say, "I want to accept Jesus Christ. I don't want to leave this day without accepting Christ in my life, the greatest promise in all of Scripture, fulfilled at Golgotha." That's the gospel, friend. That is the gospel. That is the point.
That is why we're here. Pray with me. Father God, I just pray. I pray that you will help us to see the gospel in this story, this strange story. Paul points us back to it, and he sees the gospel in it, and he invites us to look back and see the gospel in it, to see the promise made that Abraham would have a son who would be the Christ, and that Christ would live such a life, and he would fulfill the law by obeying the law, and he would fulfill our punishment by succumbing to the punishment that we deserve. But he's not dead. He is alive. Our God is alive. Father God, I pray that everybody here will accept that Christ, will accept that Messiah, will come to the Lion of Judah. Father God, if there is anybody here who is seeking to give their lives to Jesus Christ, if there's anyone here who is tired of trying to earn their way to the kingdom, if there's anyone here who is tired and frustrated and despairing for trying to earn our way into God's good graces, into your good graces, I pray that that person will come and find the peace of Jesus. Come, give their lives and their hearts to the Messiah. Father God, I pray for every person here because you've called us. You've called us into this salvation. But not just that, you've called us into a sanctification that manages to transform us into more and more like Jesus. It brings us freedom and peace and victory over sin. Lord, I pray that we will be a congregation filled with people who understand what that means. And I thank you so much that you give us also the call to go and to preach this message to all the world. This is the message that there is hope, and the hope lies not in the law, but in Jesus. Jesus alone. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So I want to let you know some things that are happening even today that I'm very excited about. I'm going to invite Michelle up. I'm going to invite Pastor Dana up. One thing, of course, is that we have prayer warriors. All the prayer warriors, raise your hands. Raise them high. If you need prayer, don't leave until you get it. Grab one of these hands and say, I need prayer. There'll be somebody right here in this room. Come over here. And there'll be someone there. There'll be someone in the first room to the right in the hall, or left. That's left. And just say, I need prayer. Or just grab them right here and say, pray for me. It may be something very specific that you just need prayer for, but it might even be, I want what Pastor Mike's talking about. I want that. I want Jesus. I'm so excited about what they're doing. There will not be Guerrilla Faith today, because we have something very exciting happening tonight, and that is a Valentine's dinner and talent show at 6:30. I hope you all come.
It's gonna be fun.
It's gonna be so fun. We're actually inviting people to dress up really nice, if you like. Mm-hmm.
Get all fancy.
And come. It's gonna be pizza. It's gonna be lasagna. There's gonna be talent. There's gonna be good laughs, good time. It's going to be a wonderful time of bonding. Please come tonight, 6:30. We're asking for a $5 donation. If that's too much, that's okay. Come anyway. Come.
And Randy just told me he's gonna brush his beard, so it's a special evening. It's a very special, fancy evening.
Good. Obviously. We were hoping.
Yeah.
We were hoping.
Tomorrow we have coffee with the pastor at 5 o'clock, and it is just a wonderful time to share together, to talk to Mike, Pastor Dana, Pastor Frank, and just be part of our community.
Right, just come if you just even need some encouragement. Come. Super Cal.
On Wednesday nights, we have Super Cal. Cal stands for Connecting on Wednesday. And Super Cal night is also Pathfinder night, so there's just a lot going on. It's fun to be here. The three classes we have going on right now, Pastor Dana is teaching a class on how to pray. Howie is teaching a class called Crafting Friendship. And if you're doing crocheting, knitting, needlepoint, any kind of craft.
We even had some people brought their coloring.
Yeah.
Bring your coloring book.
And it's just a community time working on crafts together. And then Susan Byers does music jam. And so if you want to jam with the music team, she leads out in that. It's a wonderful evening.
We have something new. That is, if it's too hard to get here or, you know, have a supper, we're going to have supper here for you. We're going to have some soup and bread. So come at 6 o'clock. We're serving soup and bread. Come have some, and it's going to be super good. So just come, and you can have food, fellowship, and just coming closer to each other and to Jesus. Also, next Sunday, not tomorrow, but next Sunday is church business meeting. There are agendas. They've been out by the TV. Grab one on your way out. All members can vote, but everyone is welcome.
We have something that's restarting this month that I'm excited about, our Wise Ones brunch. That's out over at Sam and Josie's home, and that will be happening here on February 18. So this is a fun time for our 50-plus crowd. If you identify as 50-plus, you come. Enjoy it.
Also, we're starting Children's Church on March 2. It'll be once a month. So, and it won't be, we'll sing together and then come back for a wonderful children's sermon led by Pastor Frank. So, and we're going to have Pastor Dana is going to share something about our fast forward that we've had.
So today is the end of our 21 days of prayer and fasting, and I know at our 6:30 a.m. and 6:30 p.m. Zoom calls, we've been able to share some testimonies and answers to prayer, and we've been praying, but we know that there's many of you that didn't join in that have been doing 21 days of prayer and fasting and also been praying and seeing answers, and we don't want to miss anything that the Lord's been doing these 21 days. And so if you have any testimony, please share with Mike or Michelle. We want to record them in video and post them for our
Howie
church to
well.
See.
Well,
Howie's not here right now. He got some.
Oh.
He got some this morning. Or if you want to take a selfie video on your own phone and send it to us, we would love that because we know that God is on the move, and we just want to keep encouraging each other in that. Because as we were praying, we don't even know how to pray. We don't even know what to pray. We're just praying because God said, come and pray, and the Holy Spirit's going to help us to pray. So I'm just excited to even see fasting forward what some of those answers are going to be that we just in faith started praying. But if you do have a testimony, either selfie, send it to us, or find Mike and Michelle, and we'll do a quick video just testifying to the Lord.
It's been a blessing. Hey, let me pray. Blessing over everyone. Father God, I just lift up our congregation, everyone who's here, everyone who's online, and I pray that each one will receive the gospel of Jesus Christ, that each one will receive the understanding that we have such a Messiah who has come, promised to Abraham, promised from the foundation of time, who's come and who has fulfilled the law by keeping the law, who is to come to our punishment in our place. And because of that, we have salvation. Because of that, we are made holy. And Father God, I am so grateful for the gift of Jesus. I'm so grateful for the gift of the body of Christ, people who've experienced that we can encourage each other in that growth. And I pray again, if there's anyone here who has not yet experienced that salvation, that they would just come and say, I want to experience that. We pray all of this in the name of Jesus.